rolling. All right, so day 9, final day. Pretty much everyone's packed up here at Jonah.
Yeah,
I mean, it's been a fantastic, amazing event.
It has been an amazing event. It's a ghost town right now.
It's a wet ghost town because we had a lot of rain.
A lot of rain last night.
Hell of a lot. But right now, where are we, Matt?
Yeah, so before we head out, we really need to take you guys through Pat Hartness that owns the field and has been organized at Jonah for years. Has an amazing, amazing hangar here behind us. And come on inside, we're going to take you around.
Mm-hmm.
This is a really cool project. This is a build that's in progress here. It's the
It's a big old-time aircraft,
and what's really cool about this is everyone who has come to Jonah, I think for a couple of years now, basically gets to cut a piece and sign it and put the piece on the aircraft with their name. So this thing's just got hundreds and hundreds of signatures on it, and sometime in the next couple of years it'll be completed and off it'll
maybe
go.
Maybe even next year.
Flying, it does look like it's getting there.
And of course, we put our name on there.
We're on it.
And it's in here somewhere.
It's in there.
Yeah. Are you been?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we just.
So, oh, this is 2009. I thought it said boob.
It's too many pieces in this plane. My God.
It's at the bottom sensor.
Here it is, right here. I found it.
Where is it?
It's the back side of this piece right here.
There?
Stuart Warren, Hobby King.
Woohoo!
Best part in the plane.
Next plane, friends. Next stop.
Next stop is this really, really nice J3 Piper Cub. Great and very popular cruiser from the mid-30s. Now, these were put into service during World War II, and they were known as L4 Wolf Cubs. The difference being that the rear portion was completely glazed, and there was room for a stretcher there or for a passenger. And these were great liaison aircraft in the Second World War. And actually, the last combat recorded in the European Theatre of War was between one of these, an L4 Cub,
and a Fiesler Stork.
The Marine hanging out the side of the L4 Cub because it was unarmed, and he shot down this Fiesler Stork
with a pistol.
I think it was the day of the armistice, yeah. And that was the last recorded aerial combat of the Second World War.
With a handgun?
Yeah.
This is one of my personal favorites. This is a PT-17 Stearman. Just an awesome, awesome airplane. You really haven't lived until you've been in the back seat of one of these with a canvas seatbelt over your shoulders hanging upside down at 11,000 feet. That really makes your day. Man.
Great iconic aircraft, and of course a classic trainer of the Second World War. There was schemes between the United States Army Air Force and the RAF, where RAF students would come over to California and places in America. Great flying weather all year round, and they were many RAF pilots would train on these Stearmans. In service in the RAF, they were known as the Cadet. But just a stunning aircraft. And a point of note, we've actually got a PT-17 in the scheme. Basically the same, this coming super hobby for us. Look out for that.
Check that out.
But this full size, beautiful, beautiful.
One of the first aircraft, Boeing. It's a Boeing Corporation aircraft. This particular one built in Wichita, Kansas. This is very, very unusual. You see a lot of primary trainers. You do not see a lot of BT-13s. This is one of the very early Second World War primary trainers, particularly for naval pilots. Really, Pat's got an incredible collection. This is a very unusual plane.
Now, if you look at it, it has similarities to the 86 Texan. And you can see that looking at the side, but you'll notice it's got fixed undercarriage. And essentially the fixed geared version of the 86.
Yeah.
Now, in RAF service, this was known as the Volte. But in this American scene, it's a really, really stunning rendition of a very unusual aircraft.
And this is one of the truly great motors in aviation. This is the Pratt & Whitney R985, 9-cylinder radial, one of the most iconic sounds, one of the most iconic looks in aviation when you're round motors. Round motors.
It's a pretty stunning
metal there. Yeah.
As was usual with aircraft of these times, this is fitted with the Hamilton standard prop. Now this is a variable pitch prop, unlike the PT-17, which I believe is fixed pitch. But still, an incredible combination of torque and power with the motor and prop.
Took one lever away and gave you another.
Yeah.
No gear, but they gave you a pitch.
Fantastic. Really brilliant.
So we're over in another corner of the hangar, and of course it's not just for full size because there is a lot of really, really nice models hanging here. We've got a Waco biplane over in the corner there, a very nice rendition of a Sopwith Puff above us. Sopwith Puff. And then we've got an Albatross above us there. This beast above us is in fact an RC-1.
Put a seat in it and I could fly home, but...
It's a Quaker. It's a super Quaker. Yeah, very, very good. Nice B-25 over in the corner. There's a model of the Volte up there. What's that? It's probably like a 1.7 or 1.6 scale.
Large
BT-17. That's the F model. The big, big Lazy B up here. That's quite impressive.
It's quite impressive.
It's got bike wheels on it.
So this is very, very special for me. This is... Wow. I've seen this aircraft more times than I can tell you. At Oshkosh, at the big Experimental Aircraft Association fly-in, about 10 years ago I lost my father. He was an airline transport pilot and a Vietnam veteran, and this particular aircraft is his favorite aircraft of all time. This is the 1932 Spartan Executive. This was the world's first Learjet, basically. This was the first ultra-high dollar, ultra-high class executive aircraft in the world. There are approximately 20 of these left flying in the world today. This one is Pat's, and it was restored soup to nuts in 2005. They completely pulled the skin, replaced all the components, did everything, modernized the avionics system, and brought this thing up to date. My understanding is he still uses it quite a bit, and I can't thank him enough for doing so. So one of the special things about this particularly timeless aircraft is, of course, the R985 9-cylinder radio motor and Hamilton standard prop. Fitted with a spinner to cover the mechanism for the variable pitch, everything about this aircraft was about sleekness and about speed. One of very, very few things prior to the 1940s that would go over 200 miles an hour at all.
I mean, that's of course what you're saying about sleekness. One of the early aircraft to have retractable main gears.
Retractable gear, split flaps. See in the rear there, in particular, a full split flap mechanism that goes underneath the fuselage. It's very, very unique.
And very clean.
Very clean. Very aerodynamically clean.
Okay, so that's it for Joe Knoll 2013. Matt, I think you'd agree it's been a really, really
just
amazing
a fabulous week. Big shout out to Jose for a lot of 4 a.m. nights cutting those videos together. You guys have all enjoyed so much.
It's been incredible. I hear it say a lot, and this is pretty much the Oshkosh.
The Oshkosh of RC. It is absolutely incredible.
And you can see why, right?
Absolutely. We'll be back next year, bigger and better than ever. Don't worry, guys. We will figure out a way to sell you the products you so desperately wanted from us while we were here. And
Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for being with us. Stay tuned for the next couple of weeks as we make our way out west to Los Angeles for RCX.
That's all there is. There isn't any more.